You're on.
Okay. Welcome, everybody. It's good to see you all. Hi. My name is Shauna Duncan, and I'm Korean English ancestry, and I'll be your host today. And we have Mark Point with us. First, I want to acknowledge that UBC Learning Circle is honored to be working on the unceded traditional territory of the Musqueam people. Today, we're going to be talking about what does Aboriginal student success look like with Mark. Before we get started, I just want to acknowledge that with the UBC Learning Circle, our subject matter and stories can be sometimes triggering or upsetting for some people. And please ensure that you prepare a support system for yourself in advance, which you have easy access to. This could mean an elder, a trusted friend, family member, counselor, and or crisis number. So we're going to get started now, and I'm going to ask Mark to introduce himself. Thank you for joining us, Mark.
Thank you for asking me to be here, and hello to everybody out there. And I should tell you that well, my name is Mark Point. I'm from Chola. I'm from the Skowkale First Nation. I am a Stolo. I've lived there all my life. A few short years that I lived on campus. The rest of the time I've lived at Skowkale. And we were one of the first students that went to public school. Our mother had taken us up to St. Mary's, up in Mission. And at that time, we all rode in the back of my dad's truck, and there was 10 kids. We went into the school, sat in a room by ourselves, and my parents went in and talked to the priests. And I can remember some hollering and yelling going on, and a few short minutes, my mom told us, get back in the truck, we came home. We were enrolled in public school. So what I'd like to talk about today is, you know, how do we enjoy success? How do our kids enjoy success in school? I'm going to be using a bit of my own experience, the knowledge that I've gained through my life experience. I'm a husband, a parent, a grandparent, and I'm a great-grandparent. And I'm the third oldest of a family of 10 siblings. And so we went through some trying times when we went to school. We were some of the first Native kids that went to school in public school in Sardis. And I never ever felt I was accepted in school until we were allowed to play on school teams. And we were very good athletes. We could play ball, we could run fast, and we always made the school teams, but I never ever felt I was really accepted. Being from a family of 10, we had what you would call today a hobby farm. We had a couple of pigs, we had a cow, we had chickens, we raised our own vegetables, we had quite a large garden each year, and when we were allowed to, we shipped beans and raspberries and strawberries to a local fruit processing plant. We earned our own money. Because of that, we all had chores to do. We all had work to do when we came home. I would say that we lived a very structured life. And I used to kind of pity myself at the time because in the elementary years, we weren't allowed to play on school teams. We had work to do. We had to come home immediately after school. And we had chores. Our parents weren't really what we would call strict, but we had to carry our load. If we wanted to eat, we were told this, that we had to contribute. And in our household at that time, we had our grandfather living with us, we had aunts and uncles living with us, and we had times when we had to sit down and do homework. Our mother came with us, she walked me to school in grade one, the first day of school. And so a lot of things that when I went to school, I felt comfortable because I had the support. And so I would like to ask the audience out there, if if you could feed back to us what good parent support looks like to you, because in every community it might look different. And I think that if we could share that, we could all learn. And to me, this is one of the initial first, I think, actions of a student being successful that's necessary, and that's home and parent support. So if we could have feedback, I would love to hear it.
Okay, so we're asking the question, what does good parent support look like to you? We'd love a response from you. Anybody on video conference like to respond to that, or in webinar? We can read out your comments if you put them in. I see a few people are typing away. If you'd like to answer, it's just take a red dot off and put the green one on for your mute. People are typing, we're just waiting for it to show up. Okay, we've got a few. Is the sound turned on? Not yet, Gail. Okay. If the sound's not on?
Can you take the light?
Okay. Now it's blinking. Parents that remain supportive, engaged in a child's journey, and it means holding up your child when they succeed and when they fail, when they take on a new challenge, etc. Holding your child up, that's what Tammy says.
It actually shouldn't be blinking.
Okay. Is the sound turned on all right? People that on webinar, can you hear all right? Yes, okay, good.
Yes.
Okay, great. Would anybody like to respond to that question then? Anybody else? Sounds like some people, okay, could be a silent engagement, as in to follow the news from school and have a sense of what education program children are involved in. So that was from Avis.
Anon.
Anon?
I'm from Hoyston here.
Yes.
So, good parent support looks like to me as a parent is building relationships with teachers, staff within the school district, and being involved with parent-teacher meetings, being there and understanding the roles of the instructors, teachers, and also being involved in any activities that the students have, sports games, plays, teas, which I think good support
system. That's an excellent response. Excellent response.
We've got a couple
Thank
more
you.
Here. Interest in education is Leah. Good parenting is believing in yourself as well, Patricia. Thank you very much for all your responses. We appreciate it. Understanding that they were still learning and it's a long process, helping them as they make mistakes and acknowledging when they make efforts. That's energy.
Positive support, positive reinforcement. Excellent.
Good.
Is that what? Okay. One of my jobs as an educator, I was hired as a district vice principal in a school district up in the Fraser Valley, and I was brought on to bridge the home and the school. And there had been some problems within the school district of parents not coming to school, supporting the child, you know, like we just talked about here. And up to 40% of the population of the school district was First Nations kids. And there was quite a, I would say, dysfunctional relationship between the school and the communities. Although the school district did have a First Nations Education Committee. So I was brought in, and the schools that I was placed half-time in two different secondary schools, thought that I could fix all of their problems in 1 year. And when we did a one-year evaluation of why I was there, it was determined that the only thing that I'd achieved, aside from teaching courses, was that I became close friends with the students. And I sat down with the principals, and I was astonished to find out, these were non-native principals, I was astonished to find out that they had virtually no knowledge of the communities that these students came from, what life was like for them in their communities, their culture, the lifestyles that they lived, and the kind of things that the kids did while they were away from school. And in my work, in my doctoral research, you know, this isn't rocket science, but we have to talk about this, that the kids are only in school 6 hours a day, 5 days a week, and 18 hours a day, and Saturday and Sunday, they're in the community. And so the influence that school has on these kids is minimal. And so if there is to be any positive turnaround about child success or student success, then it has to be created through relationships. And I discovered soon in my employment with the school district that there was a horrific separation between the community and the schools. And I went to homes, I visited homes, and I visited communities. I came from that area, and the responses that people gave me was that they really did not feel accepted. The parents didn't feel they were accepted as equals when they went into the schools. They often felt they were talked down to, and sometimes they were ashamed of what their kids were doing, and because of that shame, they felt that just sort of reinforced this sort of stigma that non-Native people had about Native people, that that we're not equal to greater society. And when people think that way, they don't engage. And I had to find some way of turning this whole thought around. And I had to actually educate, first of all, the principals, the superintendent, and the teachers that would listen about community life, where the kids came from, what life was like for these kids while they were not at school. And it was quite an education process. And so I did enjoy success while I was working with that, in that job. And so engaging community, parents, grandparents, and bridging those three accesses, actually the student, school, and the home, is so very important. And not only engaging them, doing activities so that they learn about each other, so they learn to understand each other, so that they learn parents learn what actually school teachers go through, what administrators go through, and teachers and administrators learn about the communities where the students come from. And I would like to hear your experiences on those thoughts. Over to you.
What question would you like?
I would like to hear a response to from the audience on bridging communities, schools, and students. I guess, reinforce the concept of student success. If we better understand each other, it creates more communication.
So how do we build that bridge?
How do we build that bridge? And that could be for First Nation schools, because I was a principal in the First Nation schools, and that disconnect was there also.
We have some questions still from the other question. Sorry, we have some answers from the other question. So it was encouraging your child in all areas of their life, not just academics, understanding that they are still learning and it's a long process, helping them as they make their mistakes and acknowledging when they make efforts. Okay, now we've got some answers for our recent question. Respectful communication and reconciliation.
Big one. Reconciliation is a huge process.
It's Bill from Hoyston here. I just had a thought on that, just around curriculum as well. I think that the bridge building has to go both ways. We have to engage with our educators regarding our children's education. But also, I think, in terms of teaching, whether it's culture, history, all these different things, even culture days, schools that have maybe on Indigenous Day in June have some kind of a culture day where they invite different teachings into the school. These are just some of my thoughts on that. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for sharing. And anybody else like to share?
This is Ina from Hoyston. Mm-hmm. I just wanted to share some of what we are doing out here in Hoyston. Every month we have a community dinner, and we invite different organizations or people to our dinner. And we have, in the past, invited educators, school districts, our local school districts out to our community dinner. We've had up to a dozen teachers, principals that have come out from the three schools and just come out to build those relationships and have them here sharing the dinner, because wherever there's food, they'll come.
Yes.
I just wanted to share that. Yeah. That's one thing that we're doing to kind of bridge that gap.
And how long have you been doing that for?
We've had community dinners for, it's been a couple of years
it's
now.
It's been more than
years. It's been a few years we have community dinners, and we invite, we don't only invite school district educators, but we invite the police and different SLRD, and, you know, we bring in different organizations, because we not only want to bridge that gap between with education, but with other local organizations.
So it's once a month you're doing that?
Yes, do that once a month.
It's a lot of work.
It's
working.
It works.
It's working.
That's a lot of potato peeling.
Yeah. I bet.
I encourage more communities to, you know, look at that.
Yeah.
Bridges gaps between local organizations and
Is anybody else doing something like that? Is anybody else on webinar? Their community building relationships through regular sharing of food, maybe once a month or something similar to that? Or typing? Gail, it says opportunities to do events together that are not focused on school, like community cornrows, family events in the evening, beach day, etc. Leah's, I think you brought up an interesting point around the confidence of parents to engage with the school system. Gail, creating community schools that are hubs for the community during non-school hours. I know Coatlin does some activities where they welcome the community of Langley and others for a big meal too.
If I could have the stage just for a minute, when I did my first grade 4 class, we would have potluck dinners at our classroom once a month. We would invite parents, aunts, uncles, grandparents, and anybody else they wanted to. And the potluck was in the classroom. It started off slowly, and I wanted the students to feel that this was their classroom, that they owned the classroom, and it was a safe place for them. Mm-hmm. I assured the kids that we were not going to be displaying their work, that this wasn't the purpose of the gathering. It was to socialize and for the parents to know each other and to get to know their teacher and for the students to feel comfortable and proud of where they went to school and where their learning place was. Well, after the first year, we had parents out. We had so many parents and people coming into our monthly potlucks. We had to use the library. People were sitting in the hallway. We were inundated with food that people brought, and it was such a great social concept that the students began wanting to show their work. And it turned around and it worked very well, because once the students wanted to show their work, they also wanted to show quality work. We decided what kind of work we would show. And so it was a very positive move to have community come into the classroom, to have families come into the classroom in a non-threatening cultural way. And it worked very positively. And I had to move on and move into administration, so that whole concept stopped when I left, which was kind of sad.
Yeah. We've got a couple other people who've written in. There's a lot of dialogue happening in webinar land. There's a lot of writing. This is hard to keep up with for me, which is great. Where are we now? I like the idea of having an event during non-school hours to connect socially and foster that sense of community and family involvement of traditional cultural events, encouraging pride in oneself.
Absolutely. When you feel good about yourself, you can feel good about anything, whatever challenges that you would face. And that, to me, is a major problem with students and First Nations students, either in band schools or in public schools, is the confidence they feel in themselves and how they feel about being in a setting where they don't feel comfortable. Thinking Adams Lake?
Adams Lake is concentrating.
So engaging parents, engaging family, inviting them into school so that school is not a place where their kids go to 6 hours a day, so that the community, the school is part of the community, and the community feels that not only do their students participate or go to school there to learn, but community is part of what goes on in the school. And that's so very important, that community people feel comfortable there, because when decisions are made about, you know, how kids are doing or changing curriculum, and I like that thought about curriculum input that that meets community needs, that parents would engage in that discussion. And it really goes a long way when you have community meetings to try to get feedback about how the school is doing, or changes in the way the school is run. And there's so many things that the school could initiate. We used to have salmon barbecues, and we used to do a number of other things. We would take the kids on camping, and we would actually go set nets on the Fraser, camp at our spot, and eat the fish we caught as part of our science programs. And it was a wonderful thing. The parents were so afraid the first time we did it, they camped across the river from us. But we invited them to eat fish with us the next morning, and we had a good time. Kids loved it. What a way to learn. Okay, there's no more comments or questions coming in?
No, we're good to go.
Okay. I'll continue on with my life. Our home was always the center of our family. My mother hosted cultural events for community, birthdays were always celebrated. We always had huge gardens, pigs, cows, and I've talked about that already. And we were taught to earn our own way. We were taught when we were small children that when cultural events were going on, that we had to sit and listen. We had to learn discipline. We had to learn to contribute. No matter how small we had to, that our contribution was, we were expected to contribute to the overall well-being of the family and the home. And I think that those are so important lessons that young people should learn, that my experience in teaching and my experience of being a dad and a grandparent and a community member, I was a chief a number of times in our community, and I've seen so many young people that weren't taught to work and would only do something if they got paid for it. And I think that that is so wrong, because sort of makeup of what's good learning and good students look like are that young people that are asked to do things, are asked to take homework home, and are asked to bring their textbooks back to school, asked to be at school on time, and when they get to middle school and higher, they, you know, to come every day to be at school and to do your homework, to be good citizens at school, pick up after yourself. All of these small little things that make up what a good person is. I see so much of that missing from our young people today. And I have to reflect back on the things that I was taught, and the discipline that I guess that was put on me, and I didn't always feel comfortable at the time, but when I look back at it now, I think that that's really what contributed to build that foundation I say I stand on, because I don't have a problem doing the work when we are faced with work, and when we, the challenges of being good students, of listening in class, of obeying authority, of being respectful when it's time to be respectful, all of these things that I think that good people have these things that are needed to go out into the world once they've, their school years are finished, and to be successful adults. It needs to be taught at a very young age. And I would like to ask the webinar audience feedback on that, either reinforce it or add to it, or tell me I'm wrong.
What would you like me to put the question as?
They heard it.
Any responses? Are there any responses for Mark? Any input? Do you agree with him? Disagree? What do you think about discipline? It's Somebody was just giving a swat. So far, no one's answering. Maybe scared the lady.
This is a, I think that this is an area that people feel uncomfortable talking about. And it's what we call our critical conversations about how we parent, how we reinforce rules and regulations at home, and consistency of doing it day in and day out, and making sure that our kids learn to earn earn their way in this life, and that things don't come free. And essentially, it leads to another part of my conversation that if we have time, I would like to get into, and that's healing. And it's all of our jobs as parents, as grandparents, as great-grandparents, and I'm a great-grandparent, and that my wife and I have agreed that if we do nothing else for the rest of our life, we teach our grandchildren to be good citizens, and that we show them what is expected of them. We teach them our culture. We teach them that they have certain responsibilities in life, and that they have to reflect it back to us, what they know, and show us how to act respectful. And we call them on it. And sometimes their parents, who are my children, don't really feel comfortable, and I see it on their faces. But after a while, they learn to accept that, yes, grandparents have a role to play. That it's one of the whole puzzles that we need to put back together so that our individual, our family, our community, and our nations can get back to doing what we're supposed to be doing. Healing, fixing ourselves, being productive, and moving on, and stop looking to blame other people for the lot we find ourselves in. There, I said another mouthful.
I think Mark's looking for a response from the audience.
Hi, this is Anna from Washington. I had just mentioned that just before you started speaking there, yeah, that I believe that, yes, it does come from the parents. Our children are who we are. And we are the only ones that can change them. If we're going to lead a destructive life, then yes, our kids are going to be like us. And if we're going to change and look at our culture and the way things need to be, then we're teaching our kids. Now, a lot of us have lost that throughout the years, going back to our grandparents, our parents. But there comes a time when that cycle's got to be broken. And it, you know, it's got to start somewhere. I believe that, you know, it does come from us. We are teaching our children. And, you know, if we need to change that, we need to change that. Thank you.
I totally agree. Let's hear from some other brave souls.
Okay, I'll see what we've got written here. Someone says, I think while there is a resurgence of young people who are going back to our roots, some people have not been raised with those teachings. They may not have access, especially if you are off reserve. I'm doing my best to not pass on the cycles I've been given by my parents, and I catch myself and correct it. It takes a conscious effort. Thank you for sharing. Another guest. And I've made mistakes, of course, and I have not behaved as most adult way with my child. I admit to her when I make a mistake and I try again. Oh, there's another response, Davina. My daughter and her husband communicate with their 5-year-old twins without hitting or yelling at them. Angie, children are people who don't understand. I let my kids know when their actions are disappointing, and I talk to them so that they will understand that I'm disappointed and different choices they can make.
Some excellent feedback. Mm-hmm. Excellent feedback, and I think that I really honor the person who said that we have to do this ourselves, and that's so very true. Mm-hmm. We have to stop the blame game. In order for us to fix what needs to be fixed, in order for us to heal, beginning the healing journey, we need, first of all, look inward to see if we're doing and that we're comfortable in our own skin and that we love ourselves. And when we look in a mirror, that we like what we see or love what we see. And it's so important to be honest about that, because there's so many people that live every day, they've made mistakes in the past, and they carry those mistakes that they made with them. And they're down on themselves, and we have had to learn, and I have had to learn, that we can't change what has happened in the past, but we can learn from what's happened in the past. And if we continue to make the same mistakes, then we have problems. I'm not a perfect person. I've made so many mistakes. I have ghosts in the closet. I wish I could change the things that I did. But I can't. I've had to learn, and part of my healing and part of my growing up process. And I have to tell you guys that I haven't grown up till just recently. Otherwise, I wouldn't be sitting here and talking about myself and what I've done in my life. And when I say that I've dedicated my life, and my wife has dedicated her life, and my children, all of my children are grown up, and we've dedicated our lives to our young people, to raise them and to nurture them, to love them and to show them where they come from, who they are. And so that they can be happy in their own skin, and they can be confident, and they can go to school, and they can learn, and they know that they have to live a structured life. And I acknowledge and recognize that there are a lot of people that don't have those same teachings, that people struggle because of finances, because of addictions, because of lack of a good home, because of a lack of a good relationship. And how do we help these people? How do we change? And I find that to start with, we have to walk our talk. We have to do what we say we're going to do. We have to forgive ourselves. We have to learn really what love is. Love is beyond sex. Sex is something we go through when we think love is sex, and we learn after a while that, you know, really love is something that where you respect, you honor, you cherish, and you go out of your way to show that those feelings are true for the people that you do love. And one of the things that my mother told me, and I'm going to say it here, that I was so deathly afraid when I had my daughter, and my daughter is Inez, that girls have a difficult time in their life when they don't have a strong relationship with their father. And I was so desperately afraid to be a bad father. And I was always wondering if I was doing the right thing, if I was being too disciplined, if I was giving in too much. I gave her her first car. She came to EBC here. She went through nursing, went through the science program. She's a registered nurse today. She has a degree in Bachelor of Science. And she's also trying to make her life as a singer. She's done well for herself. And I have to sit back, and now she has a daughter, and life goes on. I'm so very happy that we have a positive relationship within our family. But I also have work to do within my household. I call my household all of my kids and their households. I call them, they all live under my roof. And we have problems. We have brothers that don't get along, that are jealous of each other over paddling, over old girlfriends, blah, 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 blah. And so if I'm going to be saying things about healing and how we should live and how we should talk to each other, then I have to also walk the talk. And I'm sitting here thinking about how I'm going to bring about healing under my roof. And I've talked to my wife about this, I've talked to my children about this, and I'm going to do it. And that's going to be the start of healing, because I come from also a family of 10 siblings, and you can imagine that through the years we've had our differences, and we need to get back to be a strong cultural family group that our mother put together for us. And so that's another challenge. If families are strong, families work together, families honor one another, their children reflect that on how they carry themselves, how they walk, how they go to school, how successful they are in school. So healing doesn't have a direct influence on success in school, but it's like a domino effect. If this is in place, then this will be in place. And getting back to some sort of healthy structure in our lives, and health means a huge thing here. It could mean living an alcohol and drug-free life. It could mean eating good food. It could mean exercising. It could mean a number of things. And I try to do all of the above. And success also means a number of things for students. When I was a school classroom teacher, I had a number of kids that would be away over 50% of the time. And I thought they were being successful if they improved that to 30% of the time. So being a successful student could mean a number of things. I'm throwing that out now as a hook, and I'd like some response to that. What are the different ways success looks like?
Any comments? We'd love to hear from you. What are the different ways that success looks like? What does success, student success look like to you? This could take a few minutes. Well, healthy relationships and positive ways of communicating. That's success for Gail. Anybody on video conference? Okay. It might take a little bit. Do we want to keep going until we get some responses?
Okay.
Hello, this is Simon here.
Yay.
In Hoyston.
Uh-huh.
Different ways success looks like.
Mm-hmm.
I believe that a lot of our people are lost until they find themselves, meaning finding their identity, who they are, where they come from. And I think it starts with, finding yourself. You can't move forward unless you know who you are and where you come from. there's always going to be different roadblocks when it comes to being out there and being successful. Until you know who you are and where your roots are, then there's going to be different roadblocks. So I think once we learn about who we are and where we come from, we have that cultural, going back to, I guess, the medicine well, kind of looking at the four directions and that. Mm-hmm. Our balance in life is, you know, that's a big success. And from there, then you move on to, you know, educational success, relationship success, you know. But I think it really looks deeply at yourself first, mm-hmm. how you are as a person. Thank you.
Thank you. Gail says, also, eagerness to learn new things, curiosity about the world. That's it.
Okay. Our mother played a major role in ensuring us that we knew who we were, and that's a good segue to your last comments. and that we knew the history of our family. We had a family dance troupe where we sang and danced our traditional songs. Later we raced canoes, and our family was famous for that sport throughout Salish territory. We were happy within our own skin, and we continue to be. Our grandchildren are racing, and we're getting ready. We call this time of the year, we're dusting off our canoes. We're finishing up in our winter dancing season. We're dusting off our canoes. We keep our young people busy. And to participate in winter dance and canoe racing, you have to live a good life. You have to be in good shape. You have to train. You have to eat proper food. And good old Papa has to be a part of it, and I'm Papa. And so it's so important that your young children are happy with who they are and what they know, and knowing where they come from, knowing their family histories. Because there's so many of the students I had in class didn't know anything of their family history. They didn't have their own native name. They didn't know any family songs that they might have. They didn't know anything about dance, about our traditional dancing. And I have to repeat that I was very, very fortunate and grew up in a household where language was taught, our songs were taught, our dancing was taught. I myself have been I carve traditional dugout canoes. I've done this for over 40 years now. I passed it on to my children. We race a canoe circuit. From now, we'll be putting our canoes in the water. We always say when the ice thaws at Cultus Lake, we put our canoes in the water. And we race until fall time. We have a little bit of a break. We fish, get the fish we need, and then we're back into our winter longhouse season. So we keep our children busy year round. We travel together. I've taken my family to world canoe racing events. My wife and I decided that regardless of what it costed, we were going to do this as a family. And now I see my children doing that with their families. And it's an important aspect of family life. And I see that their children are doing reasonably well in school. They listen, and I sit amongst them at family gatherings, and I ask them point blank, you know, what they're doing in their life, and that they should know that I watch what they do. And I have a very favorable response. They don't take it negatively. I think that they feel comfortable in communicating with me and talking about the things that they do on a day-to-day basis. They've made mistakes, but they've learned from their mistakes. And it's all about being comfortable in your own skin. And so I think that's an important aspect of students being successful, is for them to be confident in who they are and knowing who they are. We don't have to have the newest clothes. We don't have to have the latest gadgets. We don't have to have the latest cell phones. But if we're comfortable with who we are and where we come from and what we do, then it's a great formula for success. Because the kids learn to listen, they respect authority. Part of what we do in canoe racing and in winter longhouse is learning about authority, listening to elders, accepting teachings that are presented. And it's so very important that that whole concept of older people passing on knowledge, of passing on in their stories that they present, because whenever elders talk, they always talk in passing on stories, that there are lessons to be learned in these stories. And if we could get back to doing that, encouraging our old people that they have a place, that they're so very important in the life of the young people, that their role needs to be reinforced, and they need to be there to encourage and to help the younger people develop into being good people and to doing what they need to be doing, is so very important, that all of us have a role to do. And so I would like to hear that, feel, I would like to have feedback on that, on the role of the elders and in the community and engaging with young people.
Any comments? We'd love to hear from you about the role of elders in the community. I know the university I attended that had elders and residents and made a huge impact on my life. And I think it would be beneficial for children to have that too. Elders provide guidance and have a calming energy, which is important to children to have them near. Bravo, Lisa.
Each year, somewhere in this province is an elders gathering. And this summer, the elders' gathering is in Williams Lake. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I always felt that was missing from this gathering was that there was critical dialogue, and I call what we're having today critical dialogue, about the real role of elders. And I think that elders are the first teachers, and that learning begins at home. And all the historical information that I have read, and I'm for my dissertation, my doctoral work, talks about the elders and their role, and talks about the elders, what they taught the young people. And basically, you know, we understand the concept of worldview. And the worldview, just for anybody that doesn't know, is everything that we do, everything that we know, our stories, how we hunt, how we travel, how we arrange marriages, how we lived, our cultural beliefs, our spiritual beliefs, and all of that together in a package is our worldview. And every nation has their own worldview. And I think that not many of us have put that whole package together so that we can say, this is what we did in the past. And we know that we can't return to that kind of way of doing things. But what's important about the things that our people knew and how they survived, how they interacted with one another, how they trained their young people so that they could be responsible adults, and take those concepts and reintroduce them to how we live today. Because I repeat that 18 hours a day, the student is in the community. They're either at their home, or they're with relatives, or they're on the street. And we need to return to teaching our young people to be good people, to know that they have to be something better than people that just hang out or find the easiest way to do things when they become adults, so they don't become drug addicted, so that they don't become the numbers of our young people that find their way into our prison systems. And every Thursday I visit one of our local institutions called, and I visit our First Nations people up there. It's all men, and they're all young men, and they all have the same story. I can't tell you that story because I don't think it's proper that I tell you in this environment, but I can tell you that it's not a good story, and it's a story that we're all well aware of. And it's a problem that exists in every community. And that's sexual abuse. And how do we stop sexual abuse? One of the major ways that we stop sexual abuse is that we learn to respect one another. We learn to teach our young people about what healthy relationships look like. We learn to love each other, and we have to learn from within ourselves to be able to communicate to somebody who can help us if we feel we have a problem. Because it's our job today to stop that problem and to admit that these problems exist. They exist in every one of our families. They exist in every one of our communities. And a lot of people sweep it under the rug like it isn't there. So if we're talking about healthy young people and healthy relationships, we also have to put that issue on the table. And it's one of those critical dialogues that we need to have with one another. And I always say that we need to all put our hands on the table and talk about it. We need to talk about it in an honest, sincere manner, in a respectful manner. And we need to deal with it so that it will stop. There are many, many people that have written about healing. And I firmly believe that by putting our young people in jail does nothing to heal them. That healing has to begin in the communities. And it has to be led by and shown by people that the young people respect and love. And then comes the term forgive. We have to learn to forgive ourselves. We have to learn to forgive family. We have to learn to forgive people that have done things against us. And that's a very, very difficult thing to learn. I've gone through all of my life, I've been in the sweat lodge. And it's something that I've always been, it's been brought up to me a number of times in my fasts about forgiveness. And it's so very true that I'm a person that holds grudges. If somebody said something to me or to my family that I care about, I will never forget it. But I find that it's no use carrying those grudges because it really impedes growth, it impedes relationships. And in some cases, it's even passed on to the next generation. And the young people are carrying around grudges that their old people had, and they don't even know why. Somebody's mad at that family over there, but we don't talk to them. And it affects relationships in the home, in the family, in the community, in the nation. And it sure got silent. But we have to talk about these things. We have to address them. And it's a word that I struggle with myself, forgiveness. Because I have many faults. And I had to learn to let things go. So let's have some feedback, folks.
Any feedbacks? What is forgiveness? What does it mean? Is forgiveness forgetting? Joanne puts being open. Any other input? We'd love to hear from people. I know some powerful words. Powerful words. Letting go of what does not serve you. Being vulnerable with yourself and others. Being at peace and not letting the event affect you anymore. This is a big conversation. I'm sure there's a lot to be said.
I can just hear the thinking going on, but we're not getting any.
Being honest with yourself.
Okay, we'll move on. In my role as a district principal, I work with a lot of troubled kids. And I'm talking, when I say troubled kids, there was one of my young friends who came to school inebriated on the first day of his grade 12. And the young man had also applied to go to Easter camp that the RCMP had regularly hosted First Nations kids, and it totally negated his application when he did that. But that was the practice at that school, that the grade 12 kids came to school, loaded up the first day of school. And I used to take these kids to lunch, or I'd take them to breakfast, or we'd go in for a coffee. And I soon had the superintendent asking me why I was doing this. And I told him that these kids that they call trouble, their answer to the troubled kids was kick them out. And my immediate response was, if you kick these kids to the curb, it won't be long that they're going to be in conflict with the law. They're going to be in the radar of Child and Family Services. They'll be another number of statistics of either being in jail or find drug addicted somewhere or pregnant. And it took a while for my principal and the superintendent to get it, and they did get it after a while. And I would take these kids, and I actually had circles with them at school. And we talked about, once they learned to trust me, that I wasn't going to judge them, I wasn't going to lecture them about their actions, that I accepted them as they were and I listened to them. That they soon told me that how they acted in school was a direct result of what was going on in their outside their school life. And that's how I came to that term about, we only have them for 6 hours and they're in the community for 18 hours. Some of the kids come from really, really troubled homes. Some of the kids were drug addicted and they didn't know what to do about it. They had seen counselors, but the counselors lectured them, talked down to them. And it was my way or the highway response whenever they wanted and needed help. And so the kids needed somebody they could trust and come to and know that they wouldn't be judged. And I actually cared very deeply for these kids because I did understand that they really had no one else that they could trust. And for young people to trust an adult is a huge thing. And it wasn't long, we were having circles in my other classrooms, and I taught a number of other grades and classes, and non-native kids were asking if I would have circles, and so that they could talk about their problems and they knew that it wasn't going to leave that circle. And the whole concept of finding someone that they could trust, find someone that would listen to them without judging them, became a huge thing, because the kids that I worked with in those days, I now see as adults, and they've come up to me, most of them have come up to me and thanked me for how they were treated, and it did give them hope so that they could learn to move on and to learn that there are other things in life other than teenage problems. And so just not judging kids, listening to kids, supporting them, and suggest that there are alternatives to what they were doing in a soft way is a good way to get these kids back on track, to get them, I call it, get them back into the learning circle. And it worked really good for me. Some kids you can't reach, you know, they're too far gone, they've been abused by people they love, and I've lost kids through suicide, and it affected me deeply that we couldn't help them. But the approach in showing them that people care is a positive thing, and it's not an approach that normally is acceptable in schools today. Some school districts call them alternate kids. Some of them don't have room for alternate programs, so they have to fit into regular classroom systems. But these kids need extra support, they need extra understanding, and they need to show somebody, they need to find people they can trust that will not judge them. Those are just comments that I have, and if anybody wants to ask me any further questions or comment on that, I'd appreciate it.
Any more questions or comments on what Mark was just discussing? How do we support the youth? Any comments? I've got a comment down here that was written before. Oftentimes parents can create a catch-22 for themselves. They want to be understood by their children, so they speak, yell their rules, trying to get the child to understand. However, as Stephen Covey says, if you want to be understood, listen. Listen to your child, learn to understand. Children, like adults, need to be understood, learn to listen. Another comment, ask youth to be involved in their program development. Minutes before we start wrapping up.
Oh wow, it's going fast.
I know.
I can continue on if there are no further comments. There are a few other aspects that I like to practice when I work with kids. And there are things that a lot of people don't have time for and don't think of. And I know that when kids act up in classrooms that don't normally act up, I found that most of them were hungry, that they had couch surfed the night before, they were still in the same clothes they went home with and the day before. Mom and Dad didn't come home, they didn't know where they were, Auntie and Uncle took them in, but they didn't have any breakfast and they didn't have any lunch. And when I was the principal or the classroom teacher, I would feed them and things would change instantly. When kids didn't have good home situations, I would stay in the classroom, have a classroom open during lunchtime where they could come and do homework. And a lot of kids that have a tough life, one of their practices is not doing homework. And so once the kids began trusting me and feeling comfortable with me, I would nudge them on to come do your homework at lunchtime. We might get a pizza in. You know, those kind of things. And it began working. People began coming and doing homework in a classroom that was the res classroom. We need to be firm with our kids, but we also need to know when they need support. Educators need to be seen in the community. They need to become part of community functions. Kids love it when they see their teacher or their principal at a community function, just being part of the crowd, learning more about what communities do, what cultural events are taking place. A lot of parents wouldn't come to the school when there were parent-teacher interviews or when there were disciplinary actions because of their child had done something against the school rules. And so I began holding these sessions either in their home or in the band office. And it sort of let down the guard quite often. The homeschool coordinators or the people that work for the band with their students would often defend the student not knowing all of the facts. And when a teacher, classroom teacher, would come onto the reserve or come into the home and sit and talk with the parents, or the band admin people, it made a world of difference, because there was understanding, you've come to my turf, and they let their guards down. And I think once a greater understanding between each, you know, what I expect from your student, or what parents need to hear about what their kids are doing, in an environment where they feel safe, I think a better relationship develops, and a positive relationship can continue on from there. There's a lot of little things you could tweak, you know, to bridge that gap between home and community and student. And I had this great idea about a lot of the parents that we work with, we knew needed to heal, that had problems that, you know, they would mention when I would talk to them on the side with, you know, in a discussion that I wouldn't pass on, but I knew that they needed to heal, and maybe they could be a better person, family member, parent, if they themselves could heal. And they talked about the need to heal. And so I worked with one education committee about developing a program to heal in that community. And to my astonishment, when we began having our second meeting on how we would go about it, I had already secured a source of funding for this to take place. The community, the education committee asked me to close the door and sit down and listen to them. And they told me before they could help anybody else heal, they themselves needed to heal. And here I was, raring to go, ready to do some positive work in the community, helping parents, helping families, when the people that I wanted to be the support staff here told me that before they could help anybody else, they themselves recognized that they needed to heal. So we learn things as we go along. We learn, we have to learn to change gears quickly. We have to step back and reevaluate how we approach things. And everything that we do as educators always has to be to find ways so that our kids can realize success. Success could be getting a C when they got a D before. Success could be that they came to school 5 days this week. Success could be that they did homework for the first time. When I was at my first school, students would take textbooks home and never bring them back. And textbooks cost a lot of money. And so I would communicate with parents, and I'd go to their homes and ask them to help me, help the kids remember to bring their textbooks back. And the kids would be so proud of themselves. I brought my textbook back, Mr. Point. Great. You can take it home again. And so, you know, there are many, many things that if kids can feel good about their actions and things that they learn to do that help themselves, or learn to be better friends or students in the classroom, success comes in many, many different ways. And at the end of the day, we think success is graduating with a dogwood or a school completion, or getting through 12 years in a school. If that's what we think success is, so be it. But classroom teachers and school administrators, school support staff, even parents, success is keeping your kid in school. And I had that problem with my own kids, and I think my kids were raised well. Both their parents are teachers. I can't imagine what that would be like. They would have had a tough time with me. So, success in school is many things. And not all kids are made to be academics. But if we can get them in our institutions and they leave as young adults, and they know what they want to do, they can think critically, and they're not asking where the welfare office is. That's success. OSEAN.
Thank you. Any last comments before we start to wrap up? Any comments, questions? We'd love to hear from you. Joanne saying thank you for sharing. And earlier she said, give youth tools to help each other. No other comments? I know that this has been a very important subject and heavy at times, and I'm really very, very grateful for Mark coming and sharing. He said this is the first time he shared about his PhD research. So we appreciate him coming here and sharing today. It took him 2.5 hours to drive here this morning, so very grateful. I know it was a sensitive subject matter at some times, and if you're feeling triggered at all or having a tough time, please make sure that you access some support for yourself. Like we mentioned before, it can be an elder, trusted mentor, family member, a friend, a counselor, or maybe it's going to be a crisis contact number. And take care of yourself today. Thank you for joining us. I'll let you know what we've got coming up. We've got some more sessions. Tomorrow, we're actually going to have community conversations on HIV and AIDS. That's going to be at 10:30 tomorrow. Then we have a youth circle, another youth circle. This is going to be the third one. And that's going to be on March 15th. And we have stress and family caregiving. And that will be March 29th, and a baby-friendly learning circle, and that will be April 13th. So thank you very much for joining us, and hopefully we'll see you tomorrow.
Thank you. Thank
Did we you. Learn anything?
Education is key.
Education is key. Yeah, much appreciated. Patricia said, thank you, says Angie.
Goodbye, everybody. Have a good day.
Bye. Thank you, Mark. I really, really appreciate you coming.